1861, with the firing at Fort Sumter, Kentucky became split. We had a governor that was sympathetic to the Southern cause. We had a legislator that was definitely pro-Union. So, to keep our state from fighting amongst its own self, we declared neutrality. And that neutrality lasted from April of 1861 to September 4th of 1861, when General Leonidas Polk, also known as the Fighting Bishop because he was a bishop in Episcopal Church, invaded Kentucky with his Confederate troops. Upon that, the government of Kentucky decided to go with the Union and sought out Union support and petitioned for Union troops. That is why I'm here at Fort Duffield, which is just south of Louisville. William Tecumseh Sherman saw that this area was going to be important. Right down there is the Ohio River, 7.5 miles away downriver from the city of Louisville. And so the fort was established to create a defense, but also a vital supply line to troops, Union troops in Kentucky. Kentucky will not be able to stay out of this conflict, even though it had the hopes of remaining neutral. As the Commonwealth sees both Union and Confederate armies marching through her bluegrass, leading into several bloody conflicts, Kentucky families are going to find themselves, much like the state itself, divided. And Kentucky is one of those states in which it will truly be a brother fighting against another brother. A brother taking up arms against his fellow brother. One brother wearing the Union blue and his other brother wearing that Confederate gray. Kentucky is the birthplace of the 16th President of the United States, Abraham Lincoln, who will be leading the United States during this horrific time in our history. Kentucky is also the birthplace of the first and only president of the Confederacy, Jefferson Davis. Clearly, from the get-go, we are going to be a house divided. This class, which would normally have met on Shelbyville Road, and hopefully we will get there in a regular, normal circumstance soon, is now going to be at Austin using this format. Due to our current status with the pandemic. So, what we will be doing in this class is this. We will be looking at how the institution of slavery got us to the point to where Pierre Gustave Toutant Beauregard took up arms against his former teacher, a fellow Kentuckian, Major Robert Anderson, and fired upon him for 34 hours at Fort Sumter. From there, we will look at the people and the battles that impacted the Civil War, and fortunately, giving us a Union victory, so we don't have to have a passport to go down to Florida. After we get through those battles, we will look at the conclusion of the war and be able to finally understand why. That is what this class is going to hopefully do for you. Fort Duffield, which was named after the commanding officer of the 9th Michigan, and it was named after his father, was radically different than most of our Civil War forts that we will see built. Usually forts in the Civil War were built in a diamond shape, but due to the geography of West Point, Kentucky, the junction of the Ohio and Salt Rivers, as well as the surrounding high hills, Fort Duffield was built as a serpentine earthwork. The fort's construction began in November of 1861 and was completed by the end of December. It was equipped with 10 guns, mostly 6-pounders, and a small garrison. Those guys and those guns were there to protect the people of Louisville from a Confederate invasion, as well as making sure those soldiers in the Union Army had a supply source here from Kentucky. However, by December of 1862, just over a year, the fort was abandoned, as there was no longer a need to support the fort. This was due to General U.S. Grant's victories at Fort Henry, Fort Donelson, and Shiloh in early 1862. It is also because of Confederate General Braxton Bragg's failed campaign in Kentucky at the Battle of Perryville in October of 1862. And finally, due to the capture of the capital of Tennessee, which caused the war efforts in the West to move further away from Kentucky and deeper into the South. Troops that would have been stationed at Fort Duffield were needed more on the front further south. You do have to make a climb to get to the fort, which gives you a nice view of the Ohio River. When the fort was built, there was a 1 mile radius around the entire fort in which no trees were to be allowed. Now, as you can see, there's quite a bit of trees now. So that panoramic view that the soldiers would have had in 1861 of the Ohio River and being able to see upcoming river traffic just doesn't exist anymore due to the forest reclaiming its land. There is also 61 guys that died here at the fort. There was no combat, although one was killed by a sniper. The majority of the fellas died of sickness, mainly typhoid. Actually, throughout the entire war, out of 620,000 casualties during the war, we estimate there's over 700,000 now post-war, but we'll get into that a little bit later on another episode. Majority of those casualties were due to illnesses such as typhoid or pneumonia or TB. So there is a cemetery where you can see the 61 burial sites of those Union soldiers that defended our nation here at Fort Duffield. Going to Fort Duffield is a pretty easy drive. It takes about 40 to 45 minutes from Trinity High School. But what you'd want to do is, more than likely coming from Trinity, take the Waterson Expressway to I-65 South. You'll pass by the airports, get on to the Gene Snyder, head west, take the Dixie Highway exit. As you go about 7 miles south of Dixie, you'll be on to West Point, and then you'll see Fort Duffield hidden on your left. So it's a pretty easy drive. Listen to some good tunes. Enjoy the ride. When you get to the fort, you do have to hike up a trail to get to the fort. But there's all sorts of trails there. There's actually 9 miles of trails that you can enjoy around Fort Duffield. To get to the fort, though, as I said, it's a quarter of a mile hike. It is pretty much uphill for 900 feet, so it might be a little strenuous, but it's manageable and doable. The cool thing is, if you like hiking, nearby Fort Duffield is Bridges of the Pass, where you can still hear artillery being fired by nearby Fort Knox. So the whole area is very picturesque. Fellas, I look forward to getting to know you this semester. Thank you for joining this class. This is Season 2, Episode 1 of Coach Waggoner Civil War Journal. Thank you for having your patience and dealing with what I'm going to do for you this semester with it. I do look forward to getting to know each and every one of you this semester, and that's going to be I hope you enjoy the class as much as I enjoy teaching it. So, as I will close all my classes, remain awesome, be nice, stay safe, and I look forward to seeing you soon. See you, fellas. Take care.